am professor of art practice at UC Berkeley, and I am very interested in media innovation. So my kind of art has to do with figuring out what media we need to understand the world as it is around us today. So I'm very interested in sense making, and I think it's usually best if we do sense making together. So there's a few parts I want to do today. One is I want to introduce myself with this paper, and then I want to show some slides from my state change experience that had to do with the Barrow, Alaska, and then I want to go to the land talk conversation. I understand that some of you have a chance to look at some of the land talk reports, and I want to reflect with you together about how this kind of thing could work out. And is there anything else that I should be addressing or doing?
We're all yours until 12:20.
Okay, so actually plenty of time, right? Mm-hmm. So we could also do a break after maybe 11:30, and then after that we could do a section on data visualization, which is a specific topic that you may be interested in, right? Is that
we had a workshop last week on data visualization.
What did you do?
We looked at raw graphs.
No.
Okay. We very quickly made a data visualization in about 5 minutes, a really simple one.
Okay.
And we
okay.
did a couple of kind of conceptual exercises around, our guest speaker asked us, you know, what is the Midwest? And all of us had different ideas about which states.
Okay. Yeah. That's a good category thing. Actually, that, That brings me to one of my favorite subjects. So we'll do a whole different kind of data visualization and also data sonification. And it'll be a little wild, but it'll be useful for you because then you can take it back to sort of the less wild place that actually might work for the rest of the world, and then it'll be an inspiration, I think. So my name is Greg Niemeyer, and I grew up as the son of a ceramicist and a scientist. And the ceramicist was my mom, and she taught me how to, you know, appreciate aesthetics and do pottery and those kinds of things. And my dad's idea of education was to take us to the lab on Saturdays. And in his lab, he did some really wild vivisection. He did some really wild experiments on cats, where he took cats' eyes out of their bodies as they were alive, but of course under a narcotic situation. They were anesthetized, but he enucleated their eyes and put them into what is called the in vitro mammalian eye research preservation. So he put them into a perfused eye situation where the eye was hooked up to a artificial cardiovascular system, and it gave the eye was fed the correct solution to stay alive, and the eye would sit, and this is what he did, and this is what I grew up with. And so bear with me here. The eye would sit in the middle of this apparatus and just look. And all the data from the eye's nerve, optical nerve, was measured by electrodes. And then what he did is he gave the eye different kinds of stimuli, different brightness, different colors, and so forth, to see how the eye sees, how the visual impulse, the light turns into an electrical impulse through the eye. And that's what he did for weeks on end, and basically all his life, that's what he did. And I would go to the lab, and there would be an eye sitting there, and that's normal, right? And the thing is that for me as a kid, it was an amazing experience because there was this huge apparatus, a whole room of things built around this one little eye. And of course, the cat was somewhere, you know, basically dead, or certainly dead. And the whole thing was basically normal because I'd never seen anything else. And now that I think back on it, it was actually quite traumatic. And now I have, you know, a cat as a pet, and I can't imagine ever being able to do something like that to a cat. It's like, how could you do that? But it did help a lot of people figure out how to retain their vision with medication and so forth. So, you know, there's always some benefits to it. But the main point is that this language here does not describe in any way my emotional experience of going there and seeing this sort of Faustian bargain he was doing with keeping the eye alive artificially, and the whole effort, and how he stayed up all night trying to keep it going, and what it smelled like and what it felt like. So what's missing from all this is the key element we call experience. And this is you have a special bag. This is the first, okay, this is a big moment because I was doing a sabbatical at Stanford for a year now, and it's the first time I encounter a pen that doesn't work. Whereas at Berkeley, all the pens don't work. You don't have your own, you know. So, there's somebody going around at Stanford swapping out pens at night or something.
Taking the ones that don't work to Berkeley.
So the key point is, the science here is all accurate and whatnot, but it doesn't have any experience in it. But, I mean, it has the experience, but it doesn't have any emotional experience in it, and so it ends up being very cold. And now, if you're a trained scientific, participant in the science, you can read this and figure out what was going on and put it all together, and maybe you can extrapolate some experience from it. But this text is completely impenetrable to the average participant in society and the person that we all want to address with the kind of insight that they all need to be able to own in order to figure out how to adjust their lives to the changing world they live in. So when we talk about science, we're not talking about experience enough. And that's one of the things I want to change with my work. So maybe someday I get to enucleate an eye and put it in an art gallery and have it sitting there and looking at people, and you know, it'd be an incredibly difficult piece to set up, and I probably won't do it for ethical reasons, but it'd be very nice to have a human eye. In fact, it'd be even better if it had my father's eye once he passes away. So I'm talking to him about this, and this is a very touchy subject. But imagine, I'm like, Dad, how about when you die, like 3 minutes after you die, we remove your eye and put it into a, is that okay with you? And he's like, well, why don't you read this paper first? But for me, this would be a way to actually turn this experience I had into a publicly accessible experience that will produce a lot of questions about what kind of sacrifices are we prepared to make in order to gain knowledge and understanding about our bodies and the world we live in. And so that would be very different from this paper, and it would have a different kind of impact. So I just wanted to do that by way of introduction. So done with that. Now, let's see. Here, 1 second. It's gonna go much better if I do this. So I'm typing in gregniemeyer.com/state-change, which you can look at anytime you want. And does that look decent? You don't have to read all the stuff, I'm gonna explain what's going on. So now I'm transitioning into a similar situation where you all are familiar with the Keeling curve, right? Yes? No? Okay. The Keeling curve that demonstrates a coupling between changes in temperature and changes in CO2, especially in the last 30 or so years. Now, one station that's very well known where this measurement was made in the 60s was, or late 60s, early 70s, was which one?
Hawaii.
Hawaii, Mauna Loa, right? The on top of the volcano. Very interesting situation as well. Lovely situation with the observatory up there. Native Hawaiians are protesting the installation of the new telescope there. And one of the beautiful lines is, you know, when we want to see the stars, we just look up. And what can you say to that, right? So it's a good situation to sort of parse out. But anyways, one station is there in Mauna Loa. But it turns out Keeling had another very important idea. He wanted to measure the two most unaffected places on Earth to figure out if there is a baseline change in CO2 pollution and a correlated temperature change. And one of them was Mauna Loa, the other one was Barrow, Alaska, and we're now going to Barrow, Alaska, because I saw this graph and I want to see where they actually measure this stuff. I want to go there and say, just like my dad's setup, I wanted to see what is the experience like of actually being up there and measuring this thing. Because I imagine somebody sitting in a hut somewhere near the North Pole and, you know, capturing air samples every hour for the past 30 years in minus 100 degrees Fahrenheit or something. And what is that like? And I want to have that experience. And so I went there, and when I got off the airplane, the whole airport of Barrow, Alaska, you can't drive there. There's no roads that go up there, so you have to fly. And the whole, anybody been to Barrow here before? Okay, you should all go there. Field trip, okay? It'd be good for them, really. It'd be good for them. They deserve all the attention they can get, because Barrow is the future, and it's the future we need to deal with. So I got off the airport. The airport is built on styrofoam. So the whole runway, that's styrofoam, and on top of the styrofoam, there's a layer of tarmac, and then But the main thing is that everything is permafrost, and if you build anything on permafrost that gets warm, the permafrost melts faster, and so you have to insulate whatever you build that might get warm, such as an airplane landing on tarmac that creates heat, right? So you don't want the airplane to go right into the permafrost, you want it to stay on top, so you have to build this layer of styrofoam. It's like half a foot of styrofoam, or maybe a foot of styrofoam. And it's a little harder than the stuff that you get from Amazon, it's like a little more, but still basically styrofoam. Anyway, you get on this weird landing strip, and then you get off, and then there's a little airport, which is the size of basically looks like a hangar, like a corrugated steel hangar, and it's all pretty rough, and it's June. I came in there in June, and you walk out, and it's just like now, May, June, and you walk out, and it's freezing, and then this wind blowing, it's really cold, it's snow everywhere, and it's around 0 degrees Celsius, and I walk off from the airport, and I come to this point here, which is a Native American graveyard that has been melting into the permafrost. Here's a puddle of water. It's all supposed to be solid ice, right? Solid frozen soil, but because of global warming, the melting of the permafrost has accelerated dramatically. And here you see just this bright line. This is the ice of the Arctic Sea, and there's a bunch of kids playing on a dam of sand that was put up. So they realized that the flooding was a real problem, happened all the time, and so their solution was just to get some sand from a gravel yard, and we'll see that later, and then pile up the sand so that the beach would last a little bit longer. So this is how precarious the lifestyle is there. And not only are the graveyards being washed away, but also an entire plumbing system that was put in, and the gas and the electricity, all of which is supposed to be, you know, in the permafrost and locked into these channels that are basically tunnels. Basically, the permafrost melts away, the tunnels fall apart, and you lose your plumbing. One morning I woke up, I used the bathroom, and it sounded kind of hollow, the flush, because you know, it doesn't sound right if the pipes aren't connected anymore. Just looking down wherever the toilet was going, and there was just a hole, and what happened is the hole went to the outside of the house, and what happened is because the permafrost melted, the pipes literally just fell off the house, and they just were a foot lower than they're supposed to be. And then they're like, I was on Airbnb, and people are like, don't worry, we'll hook it up by tomorrow, it'll be fine again. And so they just put an extension pipe that was a foot longer to connect it again. And that's their daily practice, and there are multiple extension pipes all around. So that's what they need to do to make things, to keep things going. I promised you sonification as well. Let's see how we're doing the sound. I'm not hearing any sound.
The audio cable. The audio cable's in.
Yeah.
You might just need to be volume up on the wall there.
Volume up on the wall.
It went all the way up. It showed on your screen.
Okay, so yeah.
Is the audio cable plugged in both ends?
Must do. It should do something at this point.
Let's make sure it's plugged in at the other.
Oh, yeah, it's plugged in. Okay. Was that a little bit scary?
That was pretty awesome.
Yeah. You touched it. Whoa, it's working. So my colleague Chris Chafe from Karma and I did a lot of data sonifications, and one of the reasons I was interested in a Keeling curve is because he had studied the Vostok ice core. Are you familiar with the Vostok ice core? Yes. What it's like? How long is it?
3 kilometers.
3 kilometers. Yeah. Are you working on that project? You seem familiar.
Yeah.
We're recording this evening.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, yeah, good. Well, yeah, we worked together on this. I remember it's all coming back together now. Yeah. Good. So it's 3 kilometers long. Do you want to tell about what we're gonna do with that? Or should I play the sound sample first?
Go for it, yeah.
Alright. So the Vostok ice core is 3 kilometers long, and it has gas bubbles trapped in it that go back to 800,000 years of Earth history. And so as you can analyze the gas bubbles that are trapped in there, you can see the concentration of CO2, and you can also infer the temperature from the amount of deuterium in the water. And so Chris and his colleagues in the University of Vancouver put together a complete record, because another thing about science is that many different people have many different kinds of experiences in labs, and then they make papers, and the papers more or less describe similar things, but not quite. So if you imagine the ice core being 3 kilometers long, and scientists from different countries, educational backgrounds, metric versus other kinds of conventions, whatnot, studying this ice core over time, there's one scientist did it here, another scientist did it here, another scientist did it in this way, and all their papers kind of overlap, but not exactly. So they have data sets that don't quite match. And so the colleagues at Vancouver had the task of just getting the record of the entire ice core into a linear and agreeing kind of data structure. And so that was hard work that took about 2 years. And then Chris got the data from them and sonified it and put it into a 1 minute track. So we're gonna listen to this 1 minute track. And what you will hear is a sonification of CO2 levels and deuterium levels, or the CO2 concentrations and the temperatures inferred from that. And so you'll hear one curve that does one thing. I'm gonna leave this last bit of mystery. And another curve that does another thing. And then interesting things happen here. And so this is 800,000 years ago, right? And what you will see is what kinds of patterns?
Like glacial and interglacial.
How many of them?
There's eight.
So if you're a good listener, you will hear eight glacial periods in 1 minute. And let's see what that sounds like. Ready? One, two, three. Observe at the last second.
Oops.
Turn that down a little bit. Lower that. It was on fire when I came here. I don't know. So what happened there is, how would you describe what you heard at the very end?
It sounded a bit like a kettle.
It sounded very much like a kettle. And, So that obviously was the representation of this, and the crucial thing is this. So what we have in the past 300 years, which is, this is a logarithmic scale, as you can tell, very precisely done. And you can see that, that in the very end here, we have a synchronization of temperature and CO2. And that's why it doesn't go on one level, it doesn't go on one voice, it goes low, and then the other goes high, it just suddenly goes together. And that's that key tea kettle effect, where two pitches come together, right, and they go up. And so that's us, that's the Industrial Revolution, and that's what it sounds like. It's like the soundtrack of the Industrial Revolution. So to make this a little bit more clear, we're still talking about Barrow, but I'm going to show you another website that we did. Okay, so why is it so small? Anyways, here we this comes from work we did in 2007, which goes back to work we did in 2001. So since about 18 years, we've been doing air quality studies and sonifications. And what we did here is we had a bunch of small sensors that we that a Japanese television company wanted us to deploy in various locations in California, because they wanted to make an air quality portrait of California. That's cool. Japanese television, Japanese public television. They thought this was awesome, and they wanted to hear what pollution sounded like in various places. And so now you have this map, and you could click on various locations. So for example, we could go down to Hollywood. Thank you. have here is traffic going, traffic going by, and you see big trucks and small trucks, and then it's kind of impact. And the one I like the best is the beach. And the main point here is that we have two components that we draw. One is the CO2, the blue one. The red one is CO2, and then VOC, volatile organic compounds, are the blue one. And here at the beach, the concentrations are relatively low. And the Japanese TV crew is sitting there, and they're filming this big old 18-wheeler truck coming down Highway 1. And you can see where that happened, right? So we're about to hear that. And the nice thing is that you can distinguish multiple voices in sonification. And also, what you get here is a sense of anticipation, right? You see something is about to happen. You're like, oh, what's it going to sound like? What's it going to sound like? What's it going to sound like? And that's what it sounds like. So the graph itself tells the whole story, but it doesn't give you the feeling of anticipation, and therefore it doesn't give you the experience, right? And that's what we're after, experience. So now it gives you a small little example of some experience that can be had. Did anybody pick up on the melody that we're using to make this happen? There was a guitar theme, right? And did anybody pick up on what, any musicians here, anybody pick up what keys and melodies are being used here? It's the song, the famous song, you might know, it's the famous song by the Hotel California by the Beatles, distorted by the amount of pollution. So if there were no pollution, you'd hear, you can check out any time you like, but you can never leave, right? Which is very, very apt for this whole theme of global warming. At low levels, you'd get the normal version, but the more distorted, the more pollution there is, the more distorted the sound gets. And so it's the idea of the image of California being this great place to hang out that's distorted by pollution. And so that's how that worked out. Good, any questions about that? Keep going.
So these were very local air pollution sensors.
Yes, the whole objective of this project, that's a whole separate project, and I can do a, should we do a parenthesis talk about local and sensing? Which is great. Okay, so parentheses, cloudy, Cloudy McPufferson is our data hero, and a pollution hero, and you have a picture of him right here on my laptop. You see this guy? It's a cloud, and it has headphones because he's cool like that, and he has lots of eyes, and the eyes are in the box we built. The eyes were LEDs that lit up according to different levels of pollution, and we built this box with the MacArthur Grant for Manual Arts High School, and our thesis was, and this was in 2007, so today this is more of a common thing, but in 2007 the thesis was that we wanted to measure air quality where people breathe, because the EPA had this notion of, with Air Now and whatnot, airnow.gov, they had this idea to measure, as Keeling did, to find baselines. But we found out that the baselines always are in places that are not so polluted. The worst part was, the thing that really got me going on this project was that I read that there was a forest fire in Santa Barbara, and the EPA, and I was like, oh, I want to see what pollution looks like, air pollution looks like. And then I came to the site for Santa Barbara, and it said, sensors disabled due to fire. And it wasn't that the sensors were actually broken, it was that they felt that the fire was an anomaly that distorted the baseline, and therefore they didn't want to post those levels. And of course, I was like, you gotta be kidding, there's still people there who are breathing, right? And so we need to measure where people breathe and when people breathe. And so we built these little boxes for high school students, and they, that's a whole different story. It was for an alternate reality game in which they were told that their high school was going to be torn down. Always good news, right? And and they were immediately engaged. And the question was, what was going to go instead of the high school? Was it going to be a mall or a park? And depending on air quality levels that they were going to measure, they were able to decide whether, or influence the decision as to whether it was going to be a mall or a park. Now, the premise was fictional, but the air quality was real. And so they ran around and they got this story about Cloudy McPufferson, the pollution monster, which personified the data, right? So instead of having data being something abstract, we now have it as something that's an experience and a character you can relate to. And And so the kids ran around in this high school, Manual Arts High School, and they measured air quality all over the place, and they found out that the worst air quality was in their classrooms. And because that's, they have this habit of writing graffiti on the desks, right? And they're bored, they draw maybe Coggin and Parferson or something like that. And then at night, the staff comes by and they wipe this stuff off with acetone. And the acetone stays in the room because the classrooms don't have any windows because they're modular or something. And so the air quality is terrible in this classroom, and they could demonstrate this, and then they went with their graphs to the principal and said, look, we can't study because we can't pay attention because our minds are being polluted by noxious gases. And the principal was like, what's wrong with you people? You're supposed to learn English, and you're supposed to graduate at a 50% graduation rate, and now you come to me with graphs and data and explaining how this is a dire situation. They said, yes, we are, and we have the data, and we did the research. And so actually, the principal carried this message forward to the LA school board, and they passed the resolution that there will no more modulars without operational windows. So within 6 weeks, it was a summer course, within 6 weeks, we went from first measurement to policy change, and it was like a dream come true. It was like that's how it should be, and it was citizen science, right? And that's what we want. Yeah, was that
amazing timeline?
Yeah, it's, yeah. If only, and it wasn't funded by the government either. It was just, and now, what happened later on is we then took these devices and patented them. And the patent was licensed by a company that's called Acclimant. They do, if any of you are still looking for internships, you probably can go there. Acclimant, A-C-L-I-M-A. They do air quality sensing for Google Street View now and for all of Google offices. And it's funny, when an idea like that gets a lot of money added to it, then the idea totally changes, kind of like when you bake a cake, you take the powder and you add the water and then something else comes out. And so, but it's its own thing and it works, and they're doing really well with it, and I hope that they get to sense air quality where people breathe all around the world, and they now have to have the capital to do that, so that's good. But in Barrow, Alaska, there's a whole different situation with capital. Let's see here. All right, so ready to go back to Barrow? I don't know how many of you have traveled up there, but we always get these pictures of polar bears frolicking in beautiful blue icebergs and whatnot. And those are the pictures that people are sent out to get. That's when you're sent out as a photo reporter to look for this stuff. Those are pictures we want. Now, there's a polar bear somewhere here, maybe, right? And I never got close enough to it because I didn't look for that kind of picture. I just wanted to see what it's like to live in Barrow, Alaska. And what it's like to live there is that the ice is dirty, it's polluted. There's like tons of soot all over the place. It's melting, it's sloshy, and you're not supposed to go out there. My dream was to walk out on these things, and I did, and then later on, the Native American guides I worked with, they were like, you're an idiot. If you go out there by yourself ever again, we're not gonna come get you. It's not the thing to do, because you have 5 seconds of survival rate, of survival time, if you're in that water for more than 5 seconds. Mm-hmm. It's because it's too cold, and there's too much ice coming around your body, and you can't move, and it's not good, so. Not a highly repeatable experience. And so they were very upset that I went there. But what I noticed right away is that that the Arctic situation is not a thing. And science often tries to make whatever they're doing into a thing. And a thing is something, philosophically speaking, that we all agree on. It's nature, right? This pen is a thing because we all think it's a pen, right? There's very little discussion about it. It's a marker, whatever, expo marker, whatever you want to call it. But it becomes a thing because we agree on what it is. Other things that are not things are things that are more mysterious, like a dream is not a thing because it's hard to agree on exactly what happened, right, in a dream. And what's another example of something that's not a thing?
A social movement? Could be defined in many different ways by many different people.
Yeah, that's a good point. It's more complex, right? It's richer. And it's not a thing. It's like, it's many things to many people. It means many things. Like civil rights is not a thing, it's more complex, right? Good, but science often has this impulse to turn things into a thing, or to turn living creatures into a thing, and here's the classic image of the pin going through the dragonfly and turning it into a thing. It used to be a dragonfly once, but then it was captured and preserved, and now it's labeled, and it turned into an object. And the key observation was that if you go back to if you go back to any real living context, you can't make the permafrost melting into a thing. Global climate change is not a thing; it's too complex, and so therefore we can't pin it down and measure it, and it means many more things to many more people than a thing would. And here's another example of how the whole situation in Barrow is just hard to get into a thingness, because this is supposed to be the National Park Service marker of the northernmost point in the United States. And obviously it was a beautiful idea at some point, but now it's sort of abandoned. And so this is literally where the United States peters out into the ocean, and it's just gravel and sand and ice, and then North Pole. North Pole is somewhere right there. So definitely not a thing. What I saw is that the main issue there. How much do you know about the global permafrost situation? Have you discussed this before? Yes? No? Some?
It's probably a mix, yeah.
Okay, what does this say here? What is CH486? What does that mean? This is the global warming potential of methane, right? It's 86 times more powerful than CO2. And what happens when permafrost melts is that all these organisms that are trapped in the permafrost frozen become food for microbes, and the microbes eat the organic matter and convert it into CH4, and that produces massive plumes of CH4 coming out of the permafrost that were actually frozen for 3,000 years. So if we look at the carbon dating of the organic matter that's in there, it's been frozen solid for 3,000 years, and now it's being released all at once. This is a problem for many reasons. When you walk in the permafrost, you get a lot of water and grass because the ice is melting, and you see bubbles all over the place. So when you step into the permafrost, it's a really fabulous feeling because it's like walking on the softest yoga mat you've ever seen. It's like, wow, or a patch of moss. And the thing is, every step you take, there's bubbles coming up around your feet, like Pepsi or Coke or something, like a soda. There's like bubbles all over the place. And here's a single bubble that comes out around one blade of grass, and that's a methane bubble. And so basically you're walking on this carpet of bubbling methane, and it's pretty weird. Yeah, it smells accordingly too. Mm-hmm. And to give you an idea of what permafrost looks like, we can go here. And so we did a drone flight there. This is my drone pilot, me, hanging out at a research station, and we flew this drone over a Eddyflux measuring system from the Ameriflux network of flux sensors all over the world, and all over the United States, and funded by the Department of Energy, but I'm not sure how long, so we'll see. And so this video gives you a sense of the size of the permafrost, eh? It's pretty large, and it's actually, I think, it's 8 million square miles of land like that. So it's a lot, and there's bubbles coming out all over the place, and there's a lot of organic matter that's suddenly decomposing. And so what's going to happen is we're going to fly to this. It was also an experience to see how hard it is to keep these things going. So they're supposed to run, 24/7 throughout the year, but actually they often shut down, and because of various electricity supply issues and data connection issues, and they're very fragile. But they're beautiful devices, and hopefully we're not going to hit it. All right. And it's the most beautiful landscape because all these, it's like bubbling water. You see, if you look at a pot of bubbling water, you get these shapes, Voronoi patterns. Those Voronoi patterns are, if you have a bunch of dots, there are equidistant edges between those dots. And so they create these points where there's troughs and little ridges. And sometimes you see there's ice floating within the water because the melting happens from the top and the bottom at the same time. So the permafrost structure is that that you have a section of soil here. This is all research by Margaret Torn at Lawrence Berkeley Labs that I'm quoting here, so I'm going to write down Torn right there. And so she found out that this, among other scientists, that there's these ice lenses that permafrost is melting from the top because of the sunlight, right? And then it's melting from the bottom because of the seawater coming in. And the seawater is warmer than usual. And so what you have as an effect is ice lenses sitting there that are still frozen solid. And sometimes there's water forms around them, so you have these pieces of ice that are floating within water. It's very bizarre. Mm. But then, here you see ice within a lake and then underneath the lake, and it's like very layered and very complex. And this is what that landscape looks like from above. This is about 400 feet now, and I think it's a beautiful pattern. It's an amazing experience to walk around in there and to think that it's, you know, every step you take is such a small part of 8 million square miles. And so, what else do we see here? We see paths that you walk on as you go to this, because you have this little, you can't step on the, because you don't want to ruin the permafrost, because you're studying the permafrost. So you have these little plastic piers that you walk on. And if we tilt the camera up to the side, we see, you know, basically from wherever we are to the horizon, we see nothing but permafrost land. And it's beautiful and flat. 360 degrees. Come, let's turn around. There we go. So for me, all this was important because it was an experience. And basically, what we need to do is figure out how to either talk about the experience so that other people can imagine what it's like, or better yet, deliver the experience. And so what we're trying to do now is to get a cubic foot of permafrost salt that's frozen and ship it to a museum in the Bay Area, and then measure it in this fashion. So we have our cube here, and it's all permafrost with little items in it. And then we want to put it in a plexiglass container, and then sense all the gases coming off of it as it very slowly melts, and then sonify that and put that into it. Put speakers around it and little, you know, lights and whatnot, and readouts, maybe graphs. So you can go into a gallery, a museum, or exploratorium type space and watch the cube melt and see what comes out of it. We're going to melt it very, very slowly so that it lasts for a while, and so we can let the whole drama unfold. So that would be a way to bring the experience here. But this is a problem because the soil doesn't belong to me, it belongs to Native Americans. And have you heard about the Inupiat Indian treaties and corporation and all that stuff? Yes, no? Some? Okay. Anyway, so we have 8.8 million square miles of permafrost, and we have, I'm gonna let this spin around. This is the station where the Keeling curve is established. So if you look around here, that's the little house that's been measuring stuff since 1971. And this is Lieutenant Diane Perry. They have the officers' names like that. And she sits on top of this tower where the sensors are. Should I make this a little bigger? No, there's no barcode going right in there. And she's sitting up there day and night, and what happened? Now maybe we can do this, yes. There. I'm just gonna go, I'm gonna go back. Been around like that. Okay, good. Let's do that. And there's various other sensing stations there as the landscape. I'm getting so dizzy. Yeah, sorry. That's going really fast. Alright, maybe that's better. And then we're really high up there, so climbing up this thing is pretty gnarly. You see the Lieutenant Diane Perry doesn't have really long legs. That's me sitting underneath taking a picture. That's my And this is a great point to start talking about the whole, so there's scientists up there, and that's one group, a social group, and the other social group is Native Americans. The Native Americans had a long history of obviously living in the land and figuring out how to survive. And to me, working with the Native Americans was very more important ultimately than working with the scientists, because they had such a different perspective from mine, and I learned so much from them. And I made all the mistakes one could possibly make, and I was just probably rude and stupid and everything. But I, at the end of the day, I learned a lot from them, and I remain in contact with some of the collaborators I met there. And they said things like, they saw me photographing with this 360 camera, and they said, why do you always hide when you take this picture? I said, because I don't want to be in the picture. And they're like, but Greg, you were there. How could you not make that part of the picture? And so I'm like, all right, they're right. Forget it. I'll leave myself in the picture. So one aspect that's very important here is that we define our the people we work with when we go in the field as collaborators, as equals, and that we learn as much from them as they might learn from our work. And so in this case, for me, this was definitely the case. So after hanging out with them for a while, eventually they allowed me to go into the most prized possession of any Inupiat, which is their ice cellar. And their ice cellar is a cellar that's inside the permafrost, and the situation is you have a little hut like this, and then you have a ladder that goes down into the permafrost, and you have lots of pickup trucks here. They always hang out with pickup trucks, there we go. And they have a cellar that's roughly a square, a cubic space. The ladder goes all the way down. And in the cellar, they store whale meat, because that's what they hunt. So there's lots of whale meat down here. And they go down, whenever they run out of food, they go down to the cellar and get whale meat for dinner or whatever, for the next barbecue or gathering. And it's frozen down here because the permafrost is solid ice, right? So it's really cold, and the meat preserves very nicely. And if we look around here, so those are the pieces of whale meat. These are huge chunks. They're about maybe 40 pounds each. Those chunks, they're very heavy pieces of meat. And again, there's me taking pictures. And the meat just sits in there and is frozen. However, because of permafrost, the temperatures here changed, and sometimes it's not entirely frozen anymore. And so some ice cellars recently failed, and the soil there is full of bacteria that were frozen for 3,000 years. So what comes out of that soil when it melts is not only methane, but also weird bacteria. And so one thing they had is they had botulism go into the meat and poison and kill Native Americans who didn't know about the fact that it was spoiled. And who knows what else comes out of that soil when it melts. But of course, the whole Native American lifestyle is upended by the fact that the permafrost is no longer doing what it's doing. Another important thing about the cellar is that once it's emptied out, no more whale meat. Native American clans, each clan has one cellar, and they have these whaling clans, and the whaling clans go and clean out the cellar so that the whale knows of a good home to go to. The idea is that the whale selects a cellar to give itself to, and the cleaner the cellar is and the more ritually cleansed it is and so forth, the more likely it is that a whale will give itself to that particular clan in self-sacrifice. And the whale does that because the whale wants the Native Americans to. And so that's how they construct the notion of hunting, and it's a very complete thought, and it's very compelling. However, on the other end of that thought, there are songs to purify the cellars, and there's, of course, they clean it physically as well, but they sing ritual songs as well, and those songs are considered to be of the devil by the local ministers who work in Barrow. So the Native Americans today, 2017. Have this experience of singing songs that are forbidden and making sure that the church that they go to on Sundays doesn't know about it or confess that they worship the devil when they were singing these songs, because the whole idea of being in touch with animalistic rituals is basically unchristian and unclean, and you'll surely go to hell if you do these things. And so they have to pray for forgiveness after cleaning out the cellar. So they clean out the cellar, and then on Sunday they go to church, and they pray for forgiveness. And this whole thing is so bizarre and so anachronistic in a way that it definitely doesn't become a thing. It's so many different realities clashing into each other. And all that is part of the experience up there. So let's see. Okay, healing curve went up from 330 parts per million to 407 parts per million of CO2 in just a few years. Here's the top, see the little hut I mentioned, this is the top of the hut, and this is our collaborators there getting the eyes together for a big communal whale meat sharing event that they have in June. And I'm gonna skip this one. Here's the lab, the way it actually looks inside. And so to me, the interior of the lab and the interior of the whale cellar were almost similar structures with completely opposite accesses to reality, right? One of them is about measuring the air, the other one is about calling the whale to the cellar. And how are we ever gonna bridge those gaps? How are we, it's in the same place, it's the same people, but yet it's completely different mindset. You must be familiar with these kinds of things, right? You have a lab with the soundproofing because there's a lot of noise. There's various data cables. There's various pipes that bring the samples into the sensors. And there's the gas tanks that could do the calibration. And there's a workbench. And then here's the actual cylinder where this is the moment where it all happens. Here's the actual sensor where the healing curve gets measured every hour, every day. Mm-hmm. And it's still going strong. So it's cool that they do that. But it's a very different practice from the Native American practice. And what they have is they have an area set aside for scientific research and an area set aside for hunting. And there's little markers that set the two sides apart. And those markers are very important because if you're on the wrong side of the marker, you might accidentally get hunted, and you know it's not good. And accidents do happen often. There's a lot of gunplay and a lot of drinking, and it's complicated. It's not an easy place to navigate. And so, but there, the Native Americans are actually in charge of protecting the scientific land because that's a revenue source for them. And they have a very important concept called the UIC. Oh, I got the wrong pen. The Upekiewicz Inupiat Corporation, the UIC, is the result of two contradictions, and this is really interesting in terms of understanding complexity of land and ownership and identity. So, can I wipe this out?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Although that graph might have been just the right graph for what I'm trying to explain. So they had this in the 70s. A lot of oil was discovered in Purdue Bay and other locations that are Native American lands, all part of the North Slope, all part of the permafrost region. And the federal government said, "Oh, great, we found oil up there. Let's hand out licenses to people to exploit the oil." And so there was an auction, and the Native Americans showed up for that auction, essentially blocked it and said, "That's our land. You can't sell it." And it was an interesting situation for the federal government because they were like, "Well, no, you don't have rights. We have a treaty of so-and-so that says you have access to your hunting grounds and your villages, but everything else belongs to the United States. We bought it from the Russians. The Russians stole it from you. Go talk to the Russians." And the Inupiat said, "Well, let's define hunting grounds. So we hunt caribou, and the caribou, they roam across all the North Slope, and wherever they roam is part of our hunting grounds, because if they can't roam, we can't hunt them." And so they had all this, and so they got into big arguments, and at some point the Inupiat became very uncomfortable collectively, because they're used to a lifestyle where you sit in a small house, maybe a very tiny house, as a family, for an entire winter. Imagine all of us being trapped in this very room for 6 months without any really way to go outside. and just with an ice cellar full of whale meat to share, it's not a good idea to be contentious in that situation, right? You can see how the best culture is to all, for all of us to get along peacefully. So the Inupiat tradition is to make peace among each other constantly, and to be very to choose peaceful in ways. And so they were, however, realizing that they really need to fight for this land, they couldn't figure out how to do that and not lose their traditional ways of peaceful peace and little resistance and so forth. And so they either were going to lose their land or their traditional ways, or they were going to keep their land but lose their traditional ways and become aggressive fighters. And then one of them, named E. Talk Edwardson, and his peers, they collaborated on the concept of creating a corporation. And instead of being a tribe, they decided they wanted to be a corporation. And as a corporation, they could hire lawyers that would do the nasty business of fighting for them, and they could be shareholders of the corporation, thereby dividing, you know, the sort of the fighting arm of the corporation is on one side, and the, you know, the peace-loving arm of the corporation is on the other side, and the Native Americans would be shareholders of this, but they would transfer money over here so that lawyers could go fight for them. And that actually worked really, really well. And so now all the Native Americans in Barrow are shareholders of this corporation that owns the land and gets the revenue from the oil, which pays for all the infrastructural upgrades and so forth. So that was a very effective element. And I'm going to use that as a, there's so much more to talk about here. How are we doing with that? Yes, I'm going to use that as a segue into our break and into our next topic, which is that I want you to think about with me the question of what is reality made of in the first place, and how do we deal with reality? I think this is a really I see corporation is a really interesting synthesis of two very different concepts. So two concepts that seemed at odds from a third perspective, the perspective of the corporation, became something that we synthesized and connected. And so to me, oftentimes when we think about the reality and the world we live in, we end up in categories. We say either we're peace-loving or we're fierce lawyers. Either we are Native Americans or we deal with the Western way of fighting. This either or is something we get stuck in a lot because we're operating too much in categories. And if we stop thinking about categories and start thinking about waves instead, the synthesis becomes much easier. And I don't know how many of you are familiar with the basic physics of waves. You know, waves are in a medium, so forth, yeah. Okay, so light, for example, operates in waves, or sound operates in waves. And if we have one wave that's, let's say, at a frequency of 3 hertz here, and if we have another wave that's, say, at a frequency of 7 hertz here, I have to draw it again. That's not good enough. There. There. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. What kind of shape do we get when we add these two waves up? We get both constructive interference and destructive interference. So just like the UIC as a corporation, which is a shape that results from two different concepts actually not being opposed but merging, we merge these two waves, we get something like this. We get a hard to do when I'm not standing back. I'll try it again. So it goes like this. So But this would be the highest one, right? If we add these up, this is the maximum peak. This one is pretty low. This one is really low. And this one is, so it goes something like this. That's funny, normally I don't have a problem with that. There we go. So, there. So now I'm satisfied. So we have two waves that are of equal frequencies and amplitudes here, but if you add them up, you get a third wave with a very complex, by an order of magnitude more complex shape. And so if you think about this as being, say, the Native American way, and this being the Western way, and if you combine it in a corporation, you get this mix, which is a very specific but a more complex form that unites aspects of the two. And so this would be UIC, perhaps. And so when you apply wave theory to synthesis like that, things that seem so opposite suddenly, instead of being opposite, become synthetic forms or combined forms that are complex and specific, but they actually work. And so my big question for us today is how to get scientific communications and data sonifications, all these things, into that space where people can see the synthesis rather than the category, the synthesis rather than the opposition. And so when after our break, we're going to go look into those kinds of concepts some more. So let's stop there and take a 5-minute break and come back.